Council, again, good morning.
Hi, Kat.
We are here in the matter of the State of Ohio versus Joseph Urich. It's case number 15-CR-893. Record should reflect that Attorney Don Cantalamessa, Mary Beth DeGravio are present representing the State of Ohio. Joseph Urich is present with his counsel, Attorney Lynn Morrow and John Uhas. There are several preliminary matters to address before we begin. Initially, the court met with counsel before coming into court to take care of some housekeeping matters, and the defendant's oral motion to supplement their witness list by adding the expert, Dr., or is it?
Miles Beam,
without objection from the State of Ohio, is sustained. Defense did provide a report from Miles Beam to the State of Ohio, so there is certainly no prejudice if he is added to the witness list, as I believe everyone anticipated based upon the report that he would testify during the trial. On June 29th, the defendant filed a motion for a Daubert hearing. On July 7th, the State of Ohio filed a memorandum in opposition. This court is going to find that a Daubert hearing is not required, is not necessary. The issue of accident reconstruction is one that relies on matters such as physics and mathematics and is not, quote, junk science, close quote. So a Daubert hearing would not be required. The question would become whether or not the expert who is going to testify would be qualified to render an opinion, and secondly, whether or not there is sufficient information and data available to that expert to render an opinion, and that would be a matter subject to direct and cross-examination and the court's ultimate determination as to the expert's ability to render an opinion. So the motion for Daubert hearing is overruled, and again, this court will make a ruling during the party's case in chief as to whether or not any proposed expert would be qualified to render an opinion and whether or not the ultimate opinion could be rendered. There's also a motion in limine that was filed by the defendant on July 3rd. That motion is asking the court to exclude any testimony of Steve Perch or his findings or opinions. The State of Ohio did not file a reply, and after meeting with counsel, it's my understanding that the prosecutor has no intention of attempting to introduce the testimony of or any reference to Steve Perch or any of his previous findings or opinions. And finally, we were set this morning for a jury trial on Thursday, July 6th. This court received a letter from Attorney Lynn Morrow and John Uhas indicating that Dr. Urich was going to execute a waiver of his right to be tried by a jury and elect to proceed with a trial to the court. Counsel, would you approach with your client? We do. Yes. Good morning. You've just heard what I have said. First of all, do you understand that you have a right to a trial by jury?
Yes, sir.
You have a right to require that the state of Ohio prove, of course, beyond a reasonable doubt, each and every element of the charges filed against you, and a trial by jury in the Common Pleas Court would mean that the state would have to prove their case to 12 jurors, and each of them individually would be required to render a verdict after hearing all of the evidence, the arguments of counsel, and the instructions from the court, and each would be required to make a finding beyond a reasonable doubt. Do you understand that? All right. Of course, you've been indicted for one count of aggravated vehicular homicide, one count of aggravated vehicular assault, one count of operating a watercraft under the influence of alcohol and/or drugs. For the record, the state is going to dismiss count 4 from the indictment, the OVI, as it relates to the 0.08 or greater requirement, and in count 5 with failure to stop after an accident. You understand all of those counts?
Right?
And you understand the elements that the state would have to prove as it relates to each count? Do you also understand that if convicted, there is a range as to count 1? It is a felony of the second degree. It carries with it a prison sentence of from 2 to 8 years, and that would require a mandatory sentence. I would have no option as to imposing anything other than a prison sentence within that range. Do you understand that? The offense also carries with it a maximum fine of up to $15,000. Do you understand that?
Yes.
All right. It also carries with it a mandatory driver's license suspension for a period of life. Do you understand that?
Yes.
All right. Out of an abundance of caution, I'm never certain what Court of Appeals might do as it relates to possible penalties if convicted of this offense. If convicted of count 1, upon completion of any prison sentence, it would also require a period of post-release control that would be supervised by the Department of Rehabilitation and Corrections and the Adult Parole Authority. And the period of supervision in that case is, I believe, 3 years. Do you understand that?
Yes, sir.
All right. Some question? Yes. As to count 2, if convicted of aggravated vehicular assault, it carries with it a potential prison sentence of up to 3 years. Again, that would be mandatory time, so I would have no discretion as to imposing any period of probation or community control. You understand that? It carries with it a fine of up to $10,000 and a license suspension from 2 to 10 years. Do you understand that? Again, if convicted of that offense, there is the potential of a additional period of supervision known as post-release control. The term would be 3 years. Do you understand that? Again, as it relates to post-release control, a violation of that could result in an additional prison sentence of up to one half of whatever the original stated term was. Do you understand that? And if the violation was a new felony, any time on the felony must be served consecutively to any time on post-release control. Do you understand that? As it relates to the operating a vehicle or a watercraft under the influence of alcohol and or drugs, that carries with it a maximum sentence of 6 months in the Mahoning County Justice Center with mandatory minimums. In this case, if convicted, mandatory minimums would include 3 days in jail or the driver intervention program, a fine in the range of $375 to $1,075, and a license suspension of from 6 months to 3 years. Do you understand that? Finally, as it relates to count five, the failure to stop after an accident, it also is a misdemeanor of the first degree. It carries with it a maximum sentence of 6 months in the county jail, a maximum fine of $1,000, and if convicted of that offense and another, any sentence imposed on count five must be served consecutively to any time as to the other counts. Do you understand that?
Yes.
All right. Do you have any questions at all about your right to a jury trial? All right. You've had an opportunity, obviously, to discuss this right with attorneys Morrow and Juhas.
Yes.
All right. Understanding your right to a jury trial under the Constitution, both the United States and Ohio Constitution, understanding the charges that you are facing, and understanding the possible penalties that can be imposed. Is it your wish to give up your right to that jury trial and to elect to proceed with the trial to the court?
Yes.
All right. I'm going to hand you a waiver of jury trial. Ask that you go over that with counsel. Kathy, let the record reflect that Joseph Urich has appeared in open court with his counsel, that he has knowingly, intelligently, and voluntarily elected to waive his right to a trial by jury, has elected to be tried by me. He has signed this waiver along with his counsel. Dated today, court will order that it be filed and accept that waiver. Thank you, counsel. Let the record also reflect that there has been some difficulty in providing photographs that were taken by the defense expert, Miles Beam, and providing them to the state of Ohio. Apparently, there are over 560 photos, which there had been some difficulty receiving and transmitting. So counsel for the state of Ohio has requested the balance of this morning to review those 560 photos and has requested that this trial begin at 1 p.m. Without objection from the defense, the court will grant that brief period of time to go over those 500 some photos, and we will begin this trial at 1 o'clock this afternoon. Is there anything that I have left out or not addressed?
No.
Thank you.
All rise. This court is adjourned. at this time in the evening, when it wasn't uncommon for people to be out there fishing, there were actually a number of people, both on the 224 bridge, people in fishing boats, and even those at the Hyo campground that became witnesses to this case. You'll hear from a number of people as to where they were when the crash happened, what they witnessed, what exactly they heard, and what they did to assist Bruce and Brian. You'll hear from the friends of the defendant, people that knew the defendant that were with him at High Oaks on the dock right before he had left, who heard the scream for help and they went to assist the victims in this case. One thing that you'll hear consistently from the witnesses all over the lake, even those who were with the defendant, is that defendant was speeding down the lake. Not only was there no wake zone, but during this time in the evening, the speed limit was only 10 miles per hour. You also hear from the witnesses the exchange that took place after the defendant crashed into the victim's boat, how he yelled at the victims and then sped off again without offering them any assistance or sticking around to speak with the police. You'll hear the 911 calls from those witnesses that were there that called in for assistance. The witnesses will also tell you that the fishing boat they had observed sitting there had its lights on. You'll hear from the defendant's friend, Andrew Progan, the gentleman that was with the defendant that night when they started the journey of drinking before the defendant had left. You'll hear Andrew tell you how the defendant called him right after the accident and acknowledged that he did something that wasn't good. Another witness you'll hear from the bartender that was just serving defendant alcohol at Ben's restaurant that evening, who provided a statement to the police. You'll also get to see for yourself defendant drinking on surveillance video from the restaurant. Because this incident occurred on Roland Lake, which falls in both Timonium and Portage counties, there are a number of agencies that responded to the scene. Today you'll hear from Lieutenant Nolan. He was one of the first responders, and he's from Portage County Sheriff's Department. At that time, he'll tell you that all of these agencies were working together until they were able to determine who would take over the case. About an hour and a half after the crash, Lieutenant Nolan was notified that a wife was calling in to 911 saying that her husband had been in a crash, and that was Angelina Rodriguez, the wife of the defendant. You'll hear her on the call say they need to be honest before she tells dispatcher that her husband hit a boat on his way home. Lieutenant Johnson then went out to the scene. Another lieutenant from Portage County went out to the home of the defendant. The defendant admitted to Lieutenant Johnson on more than one occasion that he had been drinking that evening. The defendant maintained his story that he hit a rock and he kept going. He said he didn't hear anything, didn't see anything, wasn't sure how fast he was going, maybe 25 miles per hour. All of these were indicators of his intoxication. You'll hear from BCI, who tested the lights from the fishing boat, along with hair and tissue that was recovered from the defendant's boat, which belonged to the victim, Neil Cuppet. And lastly, you'll hear from the coroner, Dr. Dorothy King, who will explain the cause and manner of death, in this case being blunt force trauma to Neil Cuppet's head after being struck by the watercraft. The investigators from the Ohio Department of Natural Resources, often referred to as ODNR, Dave Ford and Richard McCullough will be here. Richard McCullough prepared the reconstruction of the boat crash and explained to you what exactly he did and what his findings were from this crash. Your Honor, the evidence you will hear over the next course of this week will be proof beyond a reasonable doubt that the defendant committed the crimes of aggravated vehicular homicide, aggravated vehicular assault, OVI, and failure to stop after an accident. You'll be able to find that defendant was operating his watercraft on the waters in the state of Ohio while being under the influence of alcohol. You'll hear witness statements of defendant consuming alcohol that evening. You'll hear his own admissions of consuming alcohol that evening. You'll hear about his erratic and reckless driving and how fast he was going in a no wake zone, much greater than the posted speed limit at that time. You'll hear how he left the scene instead of helping. He's a doctor. He left that scene because he was intoxicated and he was looking out for himself. He didn't call the police after the accident. Rather, it was his wife that contacted 911 an hour and a half after the incident occurred. You'll hear from Lieutenant Johnson, who spoke directly with the defendant that night, when he says he doesn't remember what happened. He thought he hit a rock, he didn't hear anything, he couldn't see anything, all of which we know to be untrue based on witness statements, but clearly show that the defendant was disoriented due to his intoxication. You will hear proof beyond reasonable doubt that the defendant was operating his boat while under the influence of alcohol and committed the crime of OPI. You also hear proof beyond reasonable doubt that based on committing the OPI that he caused the death of Neil Cuphead and caused serious physical harm to Bruce Lindenwood while operating that boat intoxicated. The evidence will be sufficient for you to find him guilty of aggravated vehicular homicide and aggravated vehicular assault. And lastly, the evidence will prove that on that waterway, the defendant failed to immediately stop at the scene of the crash and failed to remain at the scene to give any information that was necessary to police. And you will be able to find him guilty of failure to stop after an accident. That night, that defendant decided to operate that watercraft while under the influence of alcohol, and he took the life of a husband, a father, and a friend. He also caused serious physical injury to the surviving victim. And at the end of this, we ask that you find him guilty of those four crimes: aggravated vehicular homicide, aggravated vehicular assault, OBI, and failure to stop after an accident.
Thank you. Counsel?
Counsel, may it please the court. Your Honor, the evidence that you'll hear over the next few days in this courtroom will be that Joseph Yerush was not impaired, that Joseph Yerush was not reckless. That what happened was a terrible accident that night that ended Neil Brian Cuphead's life and changed everybody else's life who was involved in any way. The evidence will show that you'll hear in the next few days that this was an accident that not so long ago in a courtroom like this wouldn't have been handled in the criminal courts, but as a civil wrongful death action. A terrible accident, a tragic accident, but one that no one meant to happen. The evidence that you're going to give, Judge, will show that the accident was, as we often use the phrase today, a perfect storm, a dark night, poor lighting, poor location, and a little too much speed. The evidence that you'll hear is that on Thursday, May the 7th of 2015, Joe Yerush, his wife Angelina, and their 10-month-old daughter went to their summer home in North Benton. That's at the south end of the Berlin Reservoir. Joe and his wife, both physicians. He, as a surgeon who enlisted in the Army and has three times put himself and his talents in harm's way going overseas tours. And by harm's way, I mean harm's way. She's a family physician. This was their summer home, not from Dachau, but because, as it were, it was Angelina's residence before the two of them were married. They had both managed, you'll hear, to be able to secure that Friday to take off work, and so they had gone out Thursday night with their daughter, spent an evening at their home in North Bend. On Friday morning, they got up and hung out, you'll hear, and in the afternoon, the three of them, Joe, Angelina, and little Charlie, 10 months old at the time, Angelina, at that time, about 5 months pregnant. The three of them got on the boat. They went out onto Berlin Reservoir during the afternoon, stayed kind of in the south end of the reservoir, and I'm sure you'll see maps and diagrams before this case is over to show you that the reservoir is sort of, for analytical purposes, you know, dissected by the Route 224 bridge. This particular afternoon, on Friday afternoon, they went out and stayed on the south side. They met up with some friends at an area that they sort of call the beach, hung out there for a little bit. That's sort of on the west side of the south end of the Berlin Reservoir. Hung out there for a little bit with Andrew Krogan, a person you heard described earlier. But of course, as the evidence will show, when you've got a 10-month-old child and a 5-month pregnant wife, you can't hang out there forever. So in the neighborhood of 5 o'clock or so, make their way back to Hawthorne Drive, which is the address of the residence that they have at the south end of Berlin Reservoir. There, Joe grilled hot dogs, and the three of them, Joe, Angelina, and the young child, hung out. Later in the evening, the evidence will show you Joe got a call from this friend, Andrew Brogan, basically wanting to know if Joe would come over to Andy's campground. That campground over here, Judge, is located north of the dissecting line that I mentioned earlier, the Route 224 bridge, and on the west side of the lake. You'll hear evidence that Angelina wasn't necessarily happy about Joe leaving because it was like we're out here to hang out. There was a minor skirmish. Joe promised that he wouldn't be gone long and left, assuring her that he would be back soon. As he made his way to the campsite, once there, Joe, as Andy Krogan and two other friends, got into the truck. They drove across the bridge and went to Ben's restaurant. Some of them eat. Joe didn't eat because he'd eaten earlier. They had a couple of drinks. Evidence will show they made their way. They stayed there for probably about an hour and then made their way again back to the campsite. Joe hung out a little. You'll hear that around 11:30 or so, he called his wife, Angelina, and said, "I'm going to be home in a little bit." The evidence you'll hear, Judge, is going to show that at the time of this accident, it was a dark night, though the moon came out later after the accident. And so Joe got into his boat and headed toward the middle of the lake, toward what they call the channel, so that he could eventually make his way under the bridge down to the south end of Berlin Reservoir and make his way back to Hawthorne Lane. Within minutes of leaving the campsite, however, a violent collision occurred. It was a violent collision, as you heard. Mr. Lindemuth and Mr. Cupid were thrown out of the boat. Joe Urich himself was thrown about the boat. His glasses were knocked off. His cell phone was knocked away. He sustained injuries from that. The evidence we think is going to show, Judge, that in this case, Joe didn't know what happened. It was a collision that happened out of the blue. He didn't see anything. He didn't hear anything. And then there was this violent collision, as I've just described, and he was knocked around. His first concern became that he had hit something, a rock or a stump, poked a hole in his boat. And so, not hearing or seeing anything, he decided he needed to take off and try to get back to Hawthorne, literally before the boat sunk. And you'll see photographs of the damage, indeed, that was caused to the boat, the hole, literally all the way through the boat. When he arrived back there, he tried to get in touch with his friend Andrew to find out, like, "I hit something out there, can you find out?" And the evidence is going to show that Andrew really wasn't able to respond to him, because by this time, Andrew is one of the people who is responding to the distress call for the accident on the lake. The evidence here, Judge, is going to show that Joe spent a considerable amount of time trying to get in touch with Andrew, finding out what was going on. Andrew, of course, is not responding because he is out there trying to help. Joe continued to try to pump Andy for information, and he started to put two and two together and to realize that Andy's out on a distress call. I just hit something and I don't know what I hit. And so he began to come to the realization or start to fear that what he had hit maybe not was not a stone, maybe it was not a rock. And then the evidence you'll hear eventually confirms that as Joe and Angelina are trying to get in touch with these friends, they ultimately hear that, yes, in fact, there was a boating accident. And that's when Angelina says, "We need to call the police and we need to straighten this out." They did call the police, and as you've heard and as you'll hear during the course of this trial, Lieutenant Greg Johnson of the Portage County Sheriff's Office was told of the call from Angelina. He went to the Urich resident on Hawthorne. He spoke with Joe and Angelina. You'll hear evidence about how Joe Urich took Lieutenant Johnson down to show him the boat and the damage. Photographs were taken. You'll hear evidence that Joe told Lieutenant Johnson he didn't realize at the time that he had hit another boat. You'll hear evidence that Lieutenant Johnson complimented Joe and Angelina on calling the police. And you'll hear evidence during the time that Lieutenant Johnson, because he recorded virtually everything, that the time that Lieutenant Johnson was with Joe Urich, you'll hear several times that he said, "I see no signs of impairment." You'll hear evidence that he talked about how there was a missing step going down from the Urich residence down to the dock, and how, well, if you were able to negotiate that, that's a sign that you're not impaired. You'll hear evidence that there was a piece missing from the dock as you walk from the ground out toward where the boat was docked. And again, Lieutenant Johnson made a comment about that. And several times during the evening, Lieutenant Johnson said, "I see no sign of impairment." When you've heard everything, Your Honor, and you've applied it to the legal standards, including, of course, the standard of proof beyond all reasonable doubt, you'll conclude that the state does not prove that Joe was impaired or that Joe was reckless. Rather, the evidence is going to show in this case what I said earlier. This was a tragic accident that took Neil Cutlass' life and changed the life of everyone else involved. The evidence in this case will fail to persuade you that Joe was impaired, that Joe was reckless, and will command a verdict of not guilty. Thank you.
Thank you.